Susan Moody, and I'd like to share with you some of my reflections on my journey towards anti-racism. On some level, I have always been aware of and disturbed by racial justice. In high school, I was in a program called Youth Tutoring Youth in Newark, New Jersey. It was right after the riots in 1967, and much of the city looked what I imagine a war zone might look like. The innocent children surrounded by destruction, poverty, turmoil, and hatred deserved a better future than the one that seemed predestined for them. I did what I could, but it wasn't nearly enough. Through the years, I somehow became encapsulated in a white bubble. I lived and worked with mostly white people. Racism was bad, but what did it have to do with me? I didn't see it around me, and didn't even really know very many black people. I often wonder, how could I have been so blind for so long? What could I, living in a predominantly white suburbia, do to address racism? I couldn't think of a thing. About 4 years ago, a group of Holliston residents formed Diverse Holliston, mostly to address diversity issues within the town. I joined and got to know folks who were different from me. This was a good start. All of the events, marches, and book clubs that they sponsored helped to open my eyes to issues that I had been blind to for so very long. Still, was that enough? When I saw the life being deliberately squeezed out of George Floyd, I felt angry, disgusted, and hopeless. Something had to be done to stop the systematic killing of black men. What would that something be? And again, what could I do? I decided that educating myself was a good first step. Our church community offered several ways to start my journey towards becoming an anti-racist. I took the Mindful Anti-Racism course at Open Spirit, the anti-racism reflection group led by Tracy and Ken Wagner turned out to be a safe space in which to not only learn, but also to have deep, open, honest conversations about racism. There are so many very many ways that my thinking and beliefs have changed, but here are my top three. I have learned the importance of language and am much more careful about what I say and how I say it. I now understand the difference between intent and impact, and how very harmful microaggressions are. I now know that my and my parents' privilege was given to us and not earned, and that it has had an enormous impact on our ability to succeed and have a good life. My youngest son had tried for years to help me recognize my privilege, but I could not understand it. How could I be privileged? I came from a blue-collar background. I'm middle class. To me, privilege used to mean being financially wealthy. I now know better. I am not a racist in the same way that members of the Ku Klux Klan are. As a matter of fact, until recently, I would have bristled at being called racist. However, until I truly become anti-racist, I am racist. I definitely have benefited and continue to benefit from the white supremacy culture that defines our country. Although I am not yet sure how to, I must find a way to start dismantling this culture. Going forward, I plan to train folks in how to be an active bystander through the TAB program with the hope of reducing harm doing in Metro West. I will continue to educate myself and will share those learnings with others in the hopes of spreading awareness of racial injustice. This includes exploring and hopefully adopting the eighth principle. With the increased awareness of racial injustice spurred on by the tragic murder of George Floyd, I feel the time is finally right for change. If not now,